Sir, is it true that DNB means do not bother? Taking a DNB seat means that there will be no chances for cutting in surgical fields. Sir, are DNB students used as cheap labor? Sir, I've heard that the exams are so hard that I will never be able to clear it. Sir, are DNB students always inferior to MD? Sir, also I've heard that DNB people will never get married. Hi guys, welcome back to my channel. I'm Dr. Basili, a full-time orthopedic surgeon and a faculty of orthopedics. Now, in the past few weeks, I have received so many messages from so many students asking me the differences between MD and DNB. And after reading a lot of these questions, I've realized that student community has so many myths about DNB and no one is out there clearing it for them. That's when I told myself, this is 2021, someone's got to tell the reality to all the students. And I personally feel I can do a good job about it because I have not only cleared my MS as well as DNB exam in the first attempt, but also I have worked quite a lot of time in the corporate hospital training a lot of DNB students, and now I'm working in the government medical college to train a lot of MS students as well. And since the past 2 years, I've been heavily involved in conducting the examinations for both MS as well as DNB candidates. So the insights that I can share you with are priceless. And these are the kind of videos I love making for you. So be sure to hit the subscribe button if you want to be notified when I upload such videos. So without further ado, let's get on with it. So this is going to be a long video, but I want to cover everything. So it should be one video which has all the information you need before you make this decision. So these are the things that we'll be talking about. I've obviously talked about why I think I can guide you. I'll give you a little bit about the history of why we have two parallel streams of post-graduation in India. We'll talk about the training hands-on cutting. We'll talk about the academics. We'll talk about the pass rate and the difficulty in the exit exam. We'll also discuss the fee and the stipends. We'll talk about the future prospects in terms of job and in terms of jobs in medical colleges. We'll also talk about how to choose your DNB seat. And finally, once that's done, I will leave you with my closing thoughts. So hopefully you will be able to make the right choice. I would advise you to watch this video completely so that you do not have things out of context. So before moving forward, I just want to let you know how I collected your concerns. If you're not following me on Instagram, be sure to follow me there because I ask a lot of things about a lot of problems to my students. And when they ask me these questions, I try to solve their problems. So I went through all the questions that I put up and there were so many. And I have collected the most important ones, the recurring ones, and this is what I have to add to those answers. So the first question is, why two parallel streams when MD is supposed to be equal to DNB, right? You see, in India, there are two parallel medical education systems, specifically in postgraduate education. One is offered by the National Board of Examinations, NBE, and the other was offered by MCI, which is now the National Medical Council, NMC. NBE offers the DNB, which again, friends, is Diplomate in National Board, not Diploma. It has nothing to do with Diploma. On the other hand, MCI and NMC offers the MD and MS degrees. Both of these are degrees, these are not diplomas. Now, the majority of the MD and MS degrees are offered under the universities of central government, the state government, or certain deemed universities. Whereas DNB is offered under hospitals. There can be some DNBs offered in medical colleges, but most of them are offered under hospitals. And these hospitals can be government hospitals, central government, state government, trust hospitals, and even corporate private hospitals. Now, many believe the reason they exist is because a lot of the medical colleges are owned by a lot of powerful people, mostly politicians. And if they are equalized to MD and MS, a lot of students won't spend the money to buy their post-graduation seat. And that's the popular belief why there exists a very strong lobby to keep MD and MS separate from DNB. So let's not waste time discussing things that are not in our control and focus on things that we can do. So let's start busting the first myth. A lot of people say DNB should be taken for medical field and not the surgical fields. The general belief is that in medical field, all you need is a patient and investigations, and you can go back home and read about it yourself. Well, not true. And on the other hand, it is believed that a surgical specialty always needs hands-on training. You need to be able to cut the patient, without which you cannot learn anything. Well, that is also not very true. You see, for surgical training, there is a definite requirement for you to have hands-on, for you to be able to cut the patient, suture the patient, and help the patient physically. But the point I'm trying to make here is that not all DNB institutes are under corporate or private hospitals. There are a lot of DNB centers that are offered by the central government in terms of the ESI my hospital, in terms of the railway hospital, that offer you the exact environment like a government hospital. A lot of patient flow and you'll get a lot of hands-on. If these are the hospitals where you're getting DNB in the surgical field, go ahead and take it. Apart from this, there'll be a lot of trust hospital, state government and district hospitals, which will also offer a lot of patient flow and hands-on. So when selecting surgical specialties in DNB, you can go for ESI, railway, trust hospitals, as well as many district or state government hospitals. But the point I'm trying to make here is that I want you to understand the mindset of the patient coming to these centers. See, there is a difference between a patient coming to a corporate or a private hospital versus a government or a private medical college. What are these mindsets? See, the patient coming to a corporate hospital is a patient who's looking for a particular consultant. This is a patient who has the cash or the insurance to pay. And obviously, they expect the best possible care. So the doctor admitting them is always under this immense pressure to deliver the best results. And because of that, he or she will be very less likely to take chances by giving the case to a postgraduate in training. So obviously, the consultants working in these hospitals will mostly be leaning towards patient care and satisfaction rather than postgraduate training and academics. On the other hand, when a patient walks into a government hospital or a medical college, the expectation is different. These are the patients who are not always financially sound, and so they are not too demanding in terms of care or in terms of who operates on them. So if the faculty working in these medical colleges have reasonable confidence in their postgraduates, they will be given the freedom to perform the procedures, obviously under supervision. Now, don't get me wrong, it's not that the government medical colleges or medical colleges in general don't offer better results in terms of patient care. They do, but they are more willing to allow the postgraduates in training to perform the procedure. So, sir, will this affect my training and the chances of cutting? Yes, to an extent it will, but not too much. See, let me go back to the medical specialty. It is believed that for a medical specialty, you don't need a lot of training. You can read about it yourself. Well, that's not true, because can you imagine learning everything without any exposure or without any kind of guidance? Of course not. So the same thing applies to surgery. So even though you might not be allowed to perform cases independently a lot, but you'll be getting a chance to see so many cases being performed by good surgeons. You can pick up their skills by looking at them. And if you have seen quite a few cases, sometimes you get the confidence to perform it on your own. And there are many private hospitals out there that allow the postgraduates to perform procedures once they establish a reasonable amount of confidence. And that's why in the end, I will suggest to you how to choose your DNP seat so that you find the better ones. Also, a side note, a lot of hospitals or medical colleges that have a lot of patient flow and the exposure will also have a lot of people working for them trying to get their hands on those patients. For example, in medical colleges, you'll have a lot of senior residents and assistant professors trying to grab those chances. Whereas in private and corporate hospitals, you'll have a lot of registrars and junior consultants trying to do them. So please keep that in mind as well. Another myth that I would like to bust is a lot of students think DNB in corporate hospitals like tertiary hospitals means that you will get everything that is very advanced, and so you will have no understanding of the basic cases and procedures. Well, that's not entirely true. There are plenty of other things that you can learn if you want to. Obviously, tertiary corporate hospitals will have a lot of infrastructure and money to spend. They will have subspecialties. They will have all the latest equipment. For example, in a radiology department in an advanced tertiary care hospital, the infrastructure will be so advanced that not a lot of government medical colleges or even private medical colleges can afford to have them in their arsenal. A lot of corporate hospitals will have many subspecialties, and so for people going to general surgery or general medicine, they'll find that most of the cases are referred to these specialists and they are left with only basic cases. This can work positively as well, because you get a chance to interact with specialists and then design your future based on the kind of work you see your specialists do. So I personally feel it's all about the mindset and exposure. Another added advantage the DNB students can get is in terms of learning the soft skills from these consultants working in private hospitals. A lot of these consultants are involved in a lot of marketing, self-promotion. They'll be on Instagram and Facebook or YouTube promoting their latest treatment options. They might not be always right, but they learn how to sell themselves. These are the things you can learn. You can also learn how to negotiate or bargain. And most importantly, you'll also understand how to work with VIP patients and deal with their idiosyncrasies. On the other hand, a medical college or a government medical college is less funded, so the resources are not Great. Most of the patients who come to these government medical colleges are neglected because nobody's willing to take them up, because corporate hospitals don't want to take that kind of risk. But if you look at the positive side, the medical colleges or the government medical colleges act as a treasure chest for these rare and difficult cases. So you'll have enough material to do a lot of research, paper presentations, poster presentations. So there is a flip side to everything. So let's talk about academics now. The first thing I wanted to understand is nobody's going to spoon feed you information. Those days are gone. But in medical colleges, there is a huge team of faculty, a lot of senior residents, assistant professors, associates, and professors. So learning and doubt solving can be relatively easy, because if there is a large team, and even if one of them is interested in teaching, you can get to learn a lot. Plus, in medical colleges, there'll be plenty of undergraduates whom you can teach, improving your subject. On the flip side, if DNB is taken up in a small center, then everything depends on your consultant. If they are good, you're lucky, but if they're not, you're stuck. Sometimes consultants change. So if you have built a rapport with a particular consultant and you liked his way of teaching and working, then you're suddenly met with a new consultant who works differently. This can both be a positive or a negative change, and this can affect your exit exam or your pass out rate. So let's talk about the exit exam and the passing out rate. A lot of students assume that passing out a DNB exam is very, very hard, and the examiners are there to fail you. Well, here is the reality. DNB theory exams are definitely relatively harder compared to MD and MS exams, but the correction, not so much. Now, in practical exams, this is what I've noticed. The reason many students find practical exams hard is because it is conducted in an unfamiliar environment. For example, an MD-MS students appear for their practical exam in their own medical college, whereas a DNB student is asked to go to a different center, which is probably in a different part of the country. MD-MS students appear for the exam with their own professors, internals and externals, whereas a DNB candidate appears for a practical exam in front of all the externals he might have never met before. And another reason why DNB practical exams are considered hard are because of the present OSCE system, where you are shown a series of cases with radiological finding or lab findings, and questions are asked which you have to answer in a given amount of time. Now, I personally have been in exam halls with these students, and trust me when I say these questions are not very hard. The only challenge which most of the students feel is how they are presented on the PPT or the projector. Some students find it difficult to pick up the diagnosis on the image, and that's where they make the mistake. But these are all good, knowledgeable questions. You should know the answers of these questions if you're supposed to pass the exam. I personally feel DNB exams are much more legit because you are being examined objectively. There is no emotional bias attached to your past performance. If you are an able student, if you are a good student, you will pass, and there is no doubt about it. Then, sir, why is the pass out rate less compared to MD and MS students? Well, pause the video and look at this slide. The numbers here are not very bad. In fact, if you look at past pass out rate of DNB candidates, it would have been horrible. This is good. A lot of DNB candidates are passing out in the exams. Now, let me tell you the reasoning behind this. You see, pass out rate is dependent on the number of candidates appearing for the exam. That's how you get the percentage, right? Now, there are a lot of senior candidates who are appearing for DNB exams again and again because they are unable to clear it. And these are the candidates who got into the DNB system based on the previous interview system. There was no entry exam, so there was a lot of opportunity to get into the system through the back door. Now, I'm not saying all of them are like that, but these are the candidates who are also in the system, and these are the people who don't study very well, and neither do they put any kind of effort before going for the exam. I have met students in the practical exam whose concern was to tell me, "Ki sir, this is my fifth attempt, just let me pass." When I asked him, "What kind of case do you want?" He didn't say anything. He said, "Just let me pass." So these are the people who are not prepared for the exam. It becomes a challenge to pass them. Now, the newer candidates coming into the system based on the centralized merit counseling are quality students. They are working hard. They come prepared for the exam, and they so easily pass through. So don't let these pass numbers scare you. Passing the DNB exam is purely in your hands thanks to the OSCE system, which allows you to score well if you have studied well. Now let's talk about the fee structure and stipend. The DNB fee is fixed fee across all the specialties, across all the hospitals. It's less than 1.5 lakhs per annum. And DNB students do get a stipend. The minimum amount of stipend they get is 30 to 35,000. And they will be getting more depending on the states they are in, because the stipend for a DNB student should be equal to the stipend of an MD or MS student in a government medical college in that state. So what about the future career in terms of practice? So first thing, you can appear for a neat super specialty exam just exactly like how you would after an MD or MS. You can get jobs just like any MD or MS in a corporate hospital as a consultant without any problem. And the opportunity of jobs abroad is also equal just like an MD MS. So in terms of opportunity, both MD MS and DNB are the same. But this is what I want you to understand. People apprehensive about DNB thinking that it might not get them the job, please understand this. Even if you're an MD or MS from the most prestigious institute of the world, if you can't perform the things that you have to perform, you will be asked to leave. So don't worry too much about the degree. If you know your stuff, you will be kept in the system. Now, the other big concern is job as assistant professors in medical colleges. See, the training in MD-MS by NMC or MCI is considered as the 3-year training period as a faculty as well. So you get opportunity to become an assistant professor in a medical college. Now, if you're doing a DNB in a similar institute which offers degrees like MD and MS, your DNB is equal to MD-MS for opportunity to get into government medical colleges or private medical colleges as assistant professor. But if you're doing your DNB in a smaller hospital, then you have to do a senior residency. So this is what it is. If you're working in a hospital which has less than 500 beds, you have to do a 1-year senior residency to get into a medical college and teach as an assistant professor. And if you're working in a hospital getting your DNB which has less than 100 beds, then you have to work for 2 years as a senior resident to be given a chance to work as an assistant professor in a medical college. And this is the only important distinction that you should keep in mind if you want to get into medical colleges as an assistant professor. Otherwise, till now, everything seems rosy. Now, there are a few more other concerns that I need to address before I end this video. A lot of medical colleges offering MD-MS have seats that are permitted and not recognized. So there is always this hassle once you're finished with your MD-MS, waiting for your seats to be recognized in order to work outside or to appear for NEET SS. DNB has no such problem. All DNB seats are recognized. And even if your hospital where you're doing your DNB from closes down, and this has happened to a few of my students, if it closes down, you will be relocated by NVE to other hospitals where DNB is offered. So you're not going to miss out on much. Now, one advantage that I feel medical colleges have is the enormous campus and a lot of people working towards the end goal. It's like you'll be in the system of learning. You'll have seniors, you'll have juniors, and you will have holidays whenever the government says it's a holiday. On the other hand, DNB students by these corporate hospitals are sometimes abused and used as cheap labor. They're asked to go to these camps which are far away from their hospital. They're asked to work in departments which are not theirs. So unfortunately, these corporate hospitals use these DNB students as cheap labor and sweep them around whenever they're required. The next question is public opinion about DNB. Well, who cares what public thinks? If you can do your job honestly and sincerely with good amount of skill, nobody can say anything about it. Another question is, sir, MD and MS students are preferred for marriage over DNB guys and girls? Dude, let's just ignore that. Sir, diploma versus DNB. Now, this is where I want to talk to you. See, diploma is different from diplomate. Diploma is a 2-year course. Diplomate, that is DNB, is a 3-year degree course. So this should be a clear distinction in your mind. Now, please understand that from this year onwards, NBE is offering diplomas also. So that is a diploma by NBE, and they are again 2 years. For all intents and purposes, diplomas are always inferior to masters, that is a degree course. So keep that in mind before you make a decision. If you want to come on par with these degree holders after diploma, you have to go for either a DNB or MD to equalize your degree compared to your contemporaries. Now, coming to the most important part of the video, how to choose an institute for DNB primarily and also for MD-MS. See, the information cannot be static. Like I said, faculties move, consultants change, ownership of the hospitals change, so the infrastructure also changes. So something few years ago that was amazing will not be the same today. So this is what I suggest you do. Look at your rank, and based on your rank, look at the previous year's allocation and determine where you will get the seat that you're looking for. Pick out the 3 or 4 hospitals that you're going to get. Now, after you have done that, contact the residents working in those hospitals. Now, how do you get in touch with them? Call the hospital and ask them to connect to the duty doctor. Most of the times, it's the resident on duty. Talk to them, ask them few basic fundamental questions. Ask them about the patient flow or the caseload. Ask them about the opportunity to assist or hands-on. Ask them about the teaching faculty. Is there a consultant who likes teaching over there? What about the standard academic processes? Are there journal clubs, seminars, case presentation? Do they discuss the case preoperatively? Is there a post-op audit in the hospital? Ask about the quality of rounds and the duration of rounds. Some hospitals, the doctors just do flying rounds. In some hospitals, there are enormous amount of discussions going on the patient's bedside. Ask about the pass percentage of the seniors. And always take all the information given to you with a pinch of salt, because some residents who are working in the hospital would not like to say so many bad things about their hospital. Now ask this resident for the other contacts working in other hospitals that you have looked on the list. Contact them and ask them the same question. This is important because based on the information that you're collecting now, you will decide where you want to go. After doing that, go and do your self-research. Go to the hospital like a visitor. See how it works. See where the canteen is. See how far it is from any residential area that you're going to look up to stay. So the key word here is research, research, and research before you commit to the specialty that will design your future. Don't be lazy here. This is what I see among many students. They just want some ready-made answer to pick up their hospital. It can't happen. You have to go and do your own research, because these are the things that keep on changing year after year. So let me talk about the choice ladder. This is something that I wanted to keep in mind before you make any kind of choice. Always choose your branch over institute. Please understand that branch is the most important thing. Institute comes later. Now, if you are lucky enough to have the opportunity to pick up anything from anywhere, this is the order that I would personally prefer, and this is what I will tell you. Go for MD or MS in a good institute first. If that is not available, you can go for DNB in a good institute. If those two are not available, then you can go for MD or MS in an average institute. If that is not available, then you can go for a DNB in an average institute. And only when all of these are not available, then you should go for a diploma in a good institute. Otherwise, I would stay away from diplomas, unless that is the only thing that you're good at or you're so passionate about that specialty. So the takeaway here is, friends, not all MDMS colleges are great colleges, and not all DNB hospitals are bad hospitals. You have to do your research before you take any of them. So in the end, this is what I want you to take away from this video. I know it's been a long video, but I'm sure it must have helped you. Don't be too focused on the negatives. Don't be too focused on things going wrong. If you take a DNB, don't think that people are there waiting to fail you. No one is there to fail you. Remember that you have come from a merit seat. Your outcome will be better than your predecessors. And also look at the counseling pattern that is happening this year. MD and DNB counseling is merged together. This is a positive inclination towards the future, which is trying to equalize both these degrees. Another concern that most of you have is that you will not get enough hands-on training if you go for DNB. Please remember that once you've finished with your degree, you would still want to learn more before you go for a full-fledged practice. So always keep that in mind. You will have 2, 3, 4 years even of learning as a senior resident or a junior consultant or a fellow or an associate with a good established surgeon or a practitioner to hone your skills. Listen, you need to learn to make the most of the things that you're offered. If you're in a hospital where there is a lot of heavy work, you can up your skill. Or if you work in a hospital where there is not a lot of work, you can master your theory. In the end, both of them will help you become a better doctor. So in the end, let me just correct the question here. You ask me MDMS versus DNB, which is better? Let me just ask you this question. Which is better, just being an MBBS or an MBBS with a DNB degree? Thank you for watching till the end. I hope you find what you're looking for. I wish you all the best. I will see you on the other side. Till then, take care. Bye-bye.